In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My dear brother and sister, fraternal greetings to you from the Carmelite Fathers, and warm welcome to Carmel Light, reflection on the day's readings. It's the 24th of September, Friday of the 25th week in ordinary time. Today we remember Blessed Emily Gamelin, and Larissa will give us more details about this Canadian social worker.
On 24th September, we honor Blessed Emily Gamelin, who was a French-Canadian social worker and Roman Catholic religious sister. She is best known as the founder of the Sisters of Providence of Montreal. Emily was born on February 19, 1800, the last of 15 children born to devout parents. Of the children born to this couple, 8 died in infancy. Her mother, described as frail and delicate in health, but strong and energetic in character, lavished attention on Emily and conveyed to her by example a deep interest in the poor. Emily was a helper of the poor from the time she could walk and talk. When she was 3, a poor man carrying a large sack stopped at their home and asked for alms. Emily emptied into his sack the portion her mother had set aside from the family table, but she wept with disappointment when she saw how insignificant the offerings looked at the bottom of the sack. Emily could not be comforted until her mother permitted her to add her own small personal box of cherished possessions. The first great sorrow came into Emily's life at the age of 4 when her mother died. She was adopted by her aunt, who gave her the best education available then in Montreal. As a young woman, she prayed to know her vocation and thought of entering the religious life. However, her life took on another turn. When Emily was 23, she married John Baptist Gamelin, a leading citizen of Montreal who was financially comfortable and who shared her beliefs about the importance of charity, devotion to the poor, and commitment to religion. Her happiness was short-lived, however, when her first 2 children died within months of their birth. In 1827, her husband died after a long illness, and a year later, her 3rd and last child died. Her grief was intense, and only in the practice of charity could she find peace. She plunged into the work of the Ladies of Charity in Montreal, an association for the relief of the poor of the city. She soon discovered the plight of many elderly women, neglected by their families and relegated within their family home to an obscure corner without care or attention. Emily sold part of her property and bought a house to serve as a refuge so that she could care for some of these aged women. The first guest was 102 years old. She was followed by 15 other elderly women. Soon, more room was necessary. Despite the open ridicule of her friends, who thought it was foolish for an attractive young woman to devote herself to aged women, she purchased 2 houses in order to care for 30 residents. Emily had sole responsibility for all expenses, and her own resources were rapidly depleted. One day, she prayed at Montreal's Notre Dame Church because she did not have the money to buy food. After prayers, she continued on her way to the market, where she planned to beg at the stalls. An old man approached her and handed her 23 louis, amounting to $100, saying that it was for the poor. Emily Gamelin's life is filled with similar incidents in which she trusted completely in divine providence and was able to continue her work. The second refuge was soon overcrowded. Through prayer and generosity of a benefactor, the group moved into a building known as the Yellow House. The guests in the spacious house were now able to work on projects to earn money for some of the expenses. On September 18, 1841, the legislature granted civil incorporation to the institute under the name Corporation of the Shelter for Elderly and Invalid Women of Montreal. During this time, the Bishop of Montreal made plans to ask some women religious from Paris to become involved in and carry on the work founded by Emily Gamelin. 7 young women asked to be consecrated to the service of the poor and the invalid. The investiture took place on March 25, 1843. When a novice left 4 months later, Emily took her place and soon became a novice herself. On March 30, 1844, she became Mother Gamelin, the first superior general of the young community. During the Irish famine of 1847, many people immigrated to the United States and Canada, only to die of cholera by the thousands during passage. Mother Gamelin received 650 children orphaned by the epidemic. Other works continued with the establishment of day schools, boarding schools, shelters and places dedicated to the care of persons with mental illness and a school for those with hearing impairments. The community grew rapidly under Mother Gamelin's direction. Before she died, the community had 49 sisters and 9 houses. The Sisters of Providence's early works include ministry to persons in poverty, in prison, with mental illness, with hearing impairments and speech disorders, orphans, people with handicaps and others oppressed by suffering. Mother Gamelin became known as the Mother of the Poor, and the people called her shelters House of Providence. Near the end of August 1851, cholera returned to Montreal. Mother Gamelin contracted the disease while caring for victims of cholera. On September 23rd, in the middle of the night, Mother Gamelin awakened a sister saying, "I have the cholera. I am going to die." She passed away peacefully the very next day in the presence of her sisters. Blessed Emily Gamelin was beatified by Pope John Paul II in the year 2001. Placing all our petitions before her today, let us pray. Provident God, you whom your daughter Blessed Emily was happy to know, to love and to serve on earth, following her example, let us walk with you in this life to find and glorify you eternally. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
My dear friends, we have chosen the first reading of the day. A reading from Prophet Haggai, chapter 2, verses 1 to 9. In the second year of Darius the king, in the 7th month, on the 21st day of the month, the word of the Lord came by the hand of Haggai the prophet. Speak now to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and to all the remnant of the people, and say, who is left among you who saw this house in its former glory? How do you see it now? Is it not as nothing in your eyes? Yet, now be strong, O Zerubbabel, declares the Lord. Be strong, O Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest. Be strong, all you people of the land, declares the Lord. Work, for I am with you, declares the Lord of hosts, according to the covenant that I made with you when you came out of Egypt. My spirit remains in your midst. Fear not, For thus says the Lord of hosts, yet once more in a little while, I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land. And I will shake all nations so that the treasures of all nations shall come in. And I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine and the gold is mine, declares the Lord of hosts. The latter glory of this house shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, declares the Lord of hosts. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
It is always good for us to listen to the Lord's encouragement. Courage, Zerubbabel. Courage, Joshua, high priest. Courage, people of the whole country. To work, because I am with you. There is no encouragement greater than this, nor more effective. I am with you. My spirit will be with you. Do not be afraid. Saint Ignatius of Loyola advises that in times of desolation, we need to think about the consolation that will come, to know that the desolation will not last long, that God will help us. Indeed, He is already helping us, and that therefore we can walk with confidence and perseverance. This is the lesson of this scriptural passage from Haggai. We are in a moment of discouragement. Which of you is still alive who has seen this house in its former splendor? But now, in what condition do you see it? Compared to that, is it not reduced to nothing? The Jews returned from Egypt with great plans, with great ambitions, with great dreams. They came to rebuild the temple of God, and their imagination was filled with the descriptions of Solomon's temple and his glory. Not only that, among them were some old men who had seen the temple some 60 years ago before it was destroyed, and were now disappointed with how things were going. The reconstruction had been hampered by a thousand difficulties. There were no means to do something great and beautiful. And the prophet notes it. Isn't it reduced to nothing? And yet, in these desolating circumstances, a message of consolation is preached. Courage, God says, I am with you. I work with you. And He promises to shake heaven and earth, sea and land, to bring all the treasures of the nations to this now desolate temple. The glory of this house will be greater than it once was, says the Lord of hosts. In this place, I will give peace. The prophecy of Haggai is truly fulfilled in the new temple, which is the body of Christ, the true temple of God. It is in the body of Christ that we can meet God. Furthermore, we can all together form in the body of Christ, the true temple of God. But for this temple to be rebuilt, suffering and humiliation were necessary, as the Lord Himself explained to the two disciples on the way to Emmaus. It was necessary for Christ to suffer in order to enter into His glory. This need is found in every spiritual journey. We need to live through periods of difficulty, even humiliation, for our love to be purified, our offering to be truly worthy of God. Instead of being discouraged by difficulties, we must, precisely because of them, increase our confidence, because they are a sign that God works in us. Today it is not uncommon to hear words similar to those of the prophet Haggai. there are people who complain about the situation of the church. Before, things were wonderful. Unity, discipline, faith life, morals. Now it is no longer clear where we will end up. And what is said of the church is said of the priesthood and of the Christian life itself. Let us not be discouraged, but continually return to the mystery of Christ. Let us live with humility and trust, knowing that God is with us, that His Spirit is among us. For in these moments, our faith is tested and our love for Him proved.
Brothers and sisters, like the words of Haggai, the psalm is meant to be a source of hope to those who feel burdened and who need some sort of edification. The psalmist is besieged by faithless enemies. The only source of encouragement and uplifting is the Lord. Coming into the presence of God in the temple brings gladness and joy. Let's pray that psalm now, keeping these thoughts in mind.
Your response, hope in God, I will praise Him yet again, my saving presence and my God.
Hope in God, I will praise Him yet again, my saving presence and my God.
Give me justice, O God, and plead my cause against a nation that is faithless. From the deceitful and the cunning, rescue me, O God.
Hope in God, I will praise Him yet again, my saving presence and my God.
You, O God, are my strength. Why have you rejected me? Why do I go mourning, oppressed by the foe?
Hope in God, I will praise Him yet again, my saving presence and my God.
O send forth your light and your truth, they will guide me on. They will bring me to your holy mountain, to the place where you dwell.
Hope in God, I will praise Him yet again, my saving presence and my God.
And I will come to the altar of God, to God my joy and gladness. To you will I give thanks on the harp, O God, my God.
Hope in God, I will praise Him yet again, my saving presence and my God.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Prayer for relief from the coronavirus. Almighty and merciful God, who show your love to all creation everywhere, hear graciously the prayers we make for all those affected by the coronavirus in various parts of the world. We come before you asking for an efficacious control of the outbreak, for a healing of those affected, for the victims and their families. We thank you for blessing the efforts of our research scientists working on the development of a vaccine. We pray that these vaccines will be effective in combating the virus and its mutants and in controlling the spread of the pandemic. We pray that the vaccine be available for all our people, even the poor and those in rural areas. We pray for doctors, nurses, and health workers who are in the front line of this battle, that they be kept safe and have the strength and courage to continue their heroic efforts. We pray for the government and health authorities that they take appropriate steps for the good of the people. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, pray for God's blessing now. May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We remember today all those who are celebrating their birthdays, especially Father Anthony Stephen Carmelite, Everest Cardin from Kandivili, Mumbai, Susanna A. from Bengaluru, Joshwell Santumayer from Belwai, Kevin Mascarenhas from Melbourne, William D'Souza from Bondale, Mangalore, and Alice Rodriguez from Tottam, Udupi. Wish you all a happy birthday. God bless you. And we pray for the departed soul of Angeline D'Souza from Kuwait. May the Lord grant her eternal rest. That's all for today, my dear friends. We thank Reverend Father Noel Dikunna for sharing his reflection with us today. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.